Thank you for tuning in to Heal and Emerge Radio Broadcast. My name is Quandrea Patterson. We are breaking into a new topic this month, and our topic for the month title will be Pleased to Hear Him. Pleased to Hear Him. And by Him, we mean Jesus. Pleased to Hear Him. And the question for the month is for you to ask yourself, are you pleased to hear Him? Are you pleased to hear Him? When you hear the Word of God come forth and you hear specifically the words that Jesus is speaking, do those words please you, or do those words bother you, or do you just ignore them altogether? Ask yourself that question as we go through these topics for the month. And the monthly title is Be Pleased to Hear Him. We are going to conclude Matthew chapter 16. I left one verse out of that last month's teaching on purpose, verse number 28, because it fell under a different superscription. And I wanted to keep it with the scriptures that it was coupled with. And we are going to read Matthew chapter 17 during the month of November. Last month we covered Matthew chapter 16. And that was a pretty good topic for us. And for that month, we talked about, or we came from the topic, Signs of the Time. I'm just going to jump right in and start with Isaiah chapter 55, verses 8 to 11, which last month's topic, the demonstration of Peter and Jesus, when Jesus was saying what he must go through and what he must experience by the hands of the Pharisees, the chief priest, and the scribes, that he was telling his disciples that he was going to suffer at their hands. And he was telling them that to prepare them for what was ahead. And Peter did not receive it and started telling Jesus that these things won't happen to you. No, Lord, like your talking is not, you know, you're supposed to be saying that you're blessed and you're highly favored and you're going to prosper, and you're not supposed to be saying these things like you're going to suffer at somebody's hands. He didn't say it in those words, but I'm just kind of giving a demonstration of what we might hear today, that, you know, how Peter was countering what Jesus was saying as something negative and as something that wasn't a part of this journey. And Jesus had to rebuke him, and Jesus called him a stumbling block, and he said, "Get behind me, Satan." And he said, "You're concerned about the things of man and not the things of God." So even that was a teaching moment, and it aligns with the scripture that we're going to read in Isaiah 55 and that we read every week. It was a perfect example that demonstrates how and why we get ourselves in alignment with the scripture, because we don't think like God thinks. Our thoughts and our ways are not like His. His thoughts and His ways are much higher. When Jesus is saying this, Peter is seeing this as a negative thing, as a you're speaking like a defeated person. Your speech is bringing me down. It's not happy, happy, joy, joy. It's not positive. You know, And so he was saying, no, that won't happen, and trying to put some positive into what Jesus was speaking. And Jesus saying, your thoughts pretty much are not the thoughts of God, Peter. Your ways are not the ways of God, Peter. The way that you're thinking is beneath what God thinks, and it's beneath his ways, the way that you are acting. The way that you're acting is earthly. And God's thoughts, and we'll read this like we read every week, are higher, just like the heaven is higher than the earth. Peter's thoughts were earthly, worldly. And what Jesus was saying was heavenly, high and above these earthly thoughts and these earthly ways. And so we're going to go ahead and read Isaiah 55, 8 to 11, but I did want to keep plugging the verse passage of scriptures that we read last week. That was so perfect to explain why, when we go into these teachings, we read this scripture and we get ourselves in alignment with what God says and how he thinks, because that's how we get everything that he wants us to get out of this word. And we'll read it again and get something else out of it. But for now, for this time and this season, when we align with him, he gives us what we need to help us through today's journey, today's trials, today's life happenings. So we'll go ahead and read it, starting with verse 8. Isaiah 55, verse 8 reads, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower, and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it." And the word in the passage that we're referring to from last week was the word that Jesus spoke. I mean, it was Jesus. Jesus was the word. In that moment, he was the demonstration. And in his trying to prepare his disciples for how God was going to make his word come forth and bud, and how he was gonna use Jesus to water the earth, to bring life back into the earth that was so full of death and destruction from the fall of man. For sin is death, and we're born in sin, and that's why we must be born again. And when Jesus is telling Peter what is going to happen, he's preparing the way. He's being that word that God is sending out that will not return void, but will make a path for us to be born again into the eternal life that was intended for us when God created us in the beginning. And so that's why we read this, and we're so thankful to God that he did send his son to die for our sins, that we may have eternal life and be reunited with him. We also do our weekly prayer, which comes from Matthew chapter 6, verse 9. And this is Jesus telling the disciples how to pray. Actually, I will go up to verse number 5. In reading the prayer this week. This is Matthew chapter 6, verse number 5, and I'm going to read all the way through to verse number 15. It says, And when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray, standing in the synagogues and on their corners of the streets, that they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut the door, pray to the Father who is in the secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions, as the heathen do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things that you have need of before you ask him. In this manner, therefore, pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For if we forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. So far, the scripture. And this week, I'm going to let that prayer speak for itself. Starting from verse 5 all the way down to verse 15. That is 10 verses in the book of Matthew chapter 6. And it's very detailed. It's giving an example of what sincere prayer looks like. It looks like this as opposed to this. One is praying to bring attention to self. The other is praying with reference to God, hallowing his name, wanting his kingdom to come. One is inserting self as the driving force of the prayer. One is removing self and letting the words be all to God, giving God all the power, and not only to change what we see with our natural eyes for someone else, but to look inside of us, to shine a light inside of us and help us to deal with things that we need to deal with and focus on in us that needs to be reduced, that needs to be eliminated, that needs to be rebuked, so that we can serve God better. And then forgive us and help us to forgive others. And thank you for telling us that if we can't forgive people who have done wrong to us, then it's a sure way of landing in a place to where God won't forgive us for the things that we do. That in order to be forgiven, we have to confess our sins, and we have to forgive others if we expect to be forgiven by you. And that's the scripture. That's the prayer. In Jesus' name, help us with that. Help us with that, Lord. Help us with that. In Jesus' name. Amen. So now we'll go ahead and go into our scripture for the week. Remember, our topic for the month is pleased to hear him, or be pleased to hear him. And this is Matthew chapter 16, verse 28, and we're going to roll right into Matthew chapter 17, verse 1, and I think we're going to read 1, 2. We're going to read to verse 8. So we're going to start with Matthew chapter 17, verse 1, and we're going to read Matthew chapter 16, verse 28, and we're going to read all the way through Matthew chapter 17, verse number 8. Here beginning the reading of God's word. Assuredly, I say to you, for there are some standing here who shall not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming into his kingdom. Now after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. Then Peter answered and said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. It is good for us to be here. If you wish, let us make here 3 tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he was standing still, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and suddenly a voice came out of the cloud, saying, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. But Jesus came and touched them and said, Arise, and do not be afraid. When they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus. When they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. So far, the scripture. So, in this week, we're gonna call this topic for this week, Jesus Transfigured. Jesus Transfigured. And just to go back to what, when we are talking about Matthew chapter 16, the scriptures that this is coming, that happened before this set of scripture, Matthew chapter 24 through 26 is what we read our last month when we were talking about the way is paved, or the guidance is clear was our topic. The guidance is clear. And Jesus had just told them that if they want to follow him, if they desire to come after him, that they have to deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow him. And then he said, for the Son of, in verse 27, right before 28, for the Son of Man will come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will reward each according to their works. So that's what this is coming off of when Jesus in verse 26 is saying, assuredly I say to you that some of you will not die until you see this happen. And that was those who saw him when he was crucified, saw the very thing Peter was trying to rebuke, saw him crucified, saw him resurrected, and saw him walking the earth with the holes in his hands and the piercing in his side. So that had came to pass. This week, we're talking about the transfigured. Jesus transfigured. And we see that when he came back when he appeared to his disciples, after he just had got finished talking about all of this stuff, that they saw him in a transfigured form before he had even went to the cross. to let them know that some of them will live to see him coming back. And then Peter here, and I've heard somebody preach this before, to where when Jesus showed up with Moses and Elijah, that Peter then wanted to build a, let me see what he says exactly. He said, Peter answered and said to him, Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, let us make here three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And the preacher that I heard preaching this message was saying that this is where the different churches started to happen. When Peter is saying this, that he's trying to build, because you got to remember, Jesus said, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. The Father and I are one. And this whole salvation experience, this whole born again experience, this whole new life experience is about one God, one faith. All of us becoming one. So if you're looking at whatever you've seen with Moses, Elijah, and Jesus, Peter, if he's looking correctly, through the eyes and the ways of God, he doesn't see three different people. He sees one. So there's no need for a tabernacle for Jesus, for Moses, and for Elijah. There's only need for one tabernacle, and that is the Son of God. But religion, right? Because of the law, even because of how the Pharisees are against Jesus, you know, it can't be the same as what we're, it can't be the same God and the same word that we've known all this time. What you're doing is different. So we reject that when it all is supposed to be one. One God, one faith, one baptism, one hope. It's all supposed to be one. But even Peter here, Jesus' disciple, when he sees Jesus appearing with Moses and Elijah, wants to build three tabernacles, wants to make all of them equal and separate instead of one and united. And that's where we have to get back. We have to get to that space as believers, to where we unify one faith, one God, one baptism, one head, not all these multiple heads, all these multiple tabernacles, all these multiple ministries, all these multiple faiths, all these multiple doctrines. One God, one faith, one baptism, unified. And even when Peter said this in the scripture, it says, while he was speaking, behold, while he was speaking, saying that he will build three tabernacles, one for Jesus, one for you is what he said, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And it says immediately in the next verse, while he was speaking, behold, a cloud overshadowed them. And suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear him. And this scared the disciples. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. And Jesus, with his loving self, touched them and said, arise and do not be afraid. And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. You see how God did that? So you know that God speaking and scaring them was directly a result of them wanting to build three tabernacles, of them wanting to split the faith, of them wanting to divide it up and put Elijah and Moses on the same level as Jesus. All of it was directly connected, because when they said it, God spoke and said in a thunderous voice, so thunderous that it scared them, and said, "This is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear him." And the "hear him" has an exclamation point behind it. And Jesus, instead of being like, "Yeah, I'm his son, hear me," he touched them and said, "Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid." And then when they looked up, the voice that was comforting them, that was touching them, that was reassuring them, that was making them feel safe, was Jesus only. When they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. It is Jesus only. One God, one faith, one baptism, one Savior, one head. It's Jesus only. That might be what I named the topic, Jesus only, for this month. And then as they came down, Jesus commanded them, saying, no, that's the next week. Jesus only, verse 8, is what we're stopping with. And that's that verse. When they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. And tonight, as we listen to these scriptures and we ask ourselves those questions, are we pleased to hear him? Are we? Are we pleased to hear him? When the word comes forth and Jesus is speaking, the Pharisees were not pleased to hear him. They had a serious problem with hearing him, because he threatened their power. He threatened their vain prayers. He threatened them doing stuff for men to see them. He threatened them saying that they're teachers of this word, but really they're full of themselves. And they are high off of this lie that they're telling themselves, that they are God. They're playing this God-like appearance, or this God-like behavior, out into the public so that they can convince people that the lie that they're telling themselves is actually true. Because the more people they can get to believe that they are God, they are the chosen ones, even some, they are the Messiah, because that's Antichrist prophecy. People are going to be swept away by another gospel. And when we read our prayer this week, we read what Jesus was saying, don't be like them. And then last month, when he was saying, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And in the prayer, don't be like them when they go out saying all these vain prayers and doing things so that they can be seen by men and glorified by men. You do your stuff in secret, praying to the Father, so that the Father who sees you in secret will reward you openly. You are performing for an audience of one. You are studying for an audience of one. And that one is the Heavenly Father. And there's only one way you can get to that point. One way through those doors, and that's Jesus only. Not Elijah, not Moses, Jesus only. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear him, is what God said. Do you know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior? And if you don't, invite him into your heart. Be born again and live for him today. Be saved. And until next week, be blessed.